So this is my first time giving this presentation, so my segues may not be so hot, and some slides might go quick, some might go slow, but we'll make the best of it. You could definitely stop me anytime and ask a question. We might have to take something off, you know, offline later, but that should be good. So, you know, Mark got me here, works with me at About. About uses a lot of previous dates, so hey, About. I came here because to give this tour of Hadoop, because of the whirlwind tour of Hadoop. You guys might have noticed that there was a typo. That was my fault. I said whirlwind, not whirlwind. You might have picked that up. I don't know. So Hadoop is an open source Apache project that was inspired by Google. Google actually released a white paper about their Google file system. And they described how they used it to process some of the data they did that actually builds their, you know, infamous reverse indexes that makes everything search in the internet so fast. A couple people read this back and were like, hey, we could just, you know, reverse engineer this now. And that's pretty much what Hadoop started as. Let's reverse engineer the Google file system and MapReduce libraries. So the key points are, you know, it's designed to scale from the get-go. You could run anywhere from one to, they've actually tested on 10,000 plus machines. So it is definitely scalable. Designed for batch processing, not low latency, and designed for high throughput. And it's great at solving a set of problems that are partitionable. And we're going to get to that a little bit later. And there's two really key points, which are fault tolerance in storage and in processing. So in storage, imagine if you have a system with 10,000 computers, each with 8 drives, at any given time, 10 or 100 machines might be down. So it's unacceptable in a big file system like that to say, oh, one machine's out, the whole system's inactive. It has to recover. So what Hadoop does is manages all the replication. So you don't have to rage your systems. You actually just throw your drives in as just a bunch of disks, and Hadoop does all the management. And the same is true with fault tolerance and processing. Because if you're doing batch-based systems, you're doing a terabyte-sized data set, it's not going to finish right away. And if individual pieces of that task fail, you don't want to restart the whole job or have to be involved in managing that. So parts of the job can fail and they'll be tried. And you go back a little ways, but at least the whole job completes eventually. All right, so there's two main pieces of Hadoop, and one is the file system part, which is called HDFS. This is a user space file system. It is a user space file system. It's not a raw disk system. So you take your systems, you build them, you partition them any way you like, and HDFS just works inside a folder on those file systems. There's an inode store that's called the name node. That's one of the key components of Hadoop, which more or less stores where the files are and where their replicas are. And the data nodes actually provide the real storage. So for one name node, you'll have as many data nodes as you need. At About, we took machines with 8 terabyte drives, and those are our data nodes. So we have 8 terabytes per node, 10 nodes, but you got 80 terabytes storage there. And the replication is set per file, so if you have a certain piece of data, it's maybe critical or more important, you can up the replication. The default is usually 3, but you can take it a step higher. Sometimes upping the replication can help you with the job because there's more copies of the file. And the files are usually large. This system isn't really geared towards small files. It's geared to work on huger logs, like web logs, or huge series of data. And again, it's optimized for throughput, not low latency stuff. And the second piece is the MapReduce part. As I mentioned, the job's usually long running, sometimes an hour, sometimes a day. They can run fast. There can be sub-minute jobs, possibly, depending on how much data you're working on. And one of the key concepts is to move the processing, not the data. So if you can imagine you're doing this job and all the nodes are equal, so the process I want to run, my programming process, I don't have to get the file, bring it locally, operate on it, and put it back somewhere. The framework runs the code, hopefully, where the data is. So that's a quick optimization. And the algorithm uses two components, which are map and reduce. We're going to talk about that a bit, but we'll get into that. So the way this basically goes is no matter how big your input is, it's split. So if it's a file, imagine it's just split in chunks, whether they be 128 megabyte chunks or gigabyte chunks. And because you can split the file in chunks, you can process it in chunks. Ah, things you don't have. So there's a few things you don't have, which are, you know, locking, blocking, because all these would be, it's really a share nothing architecture, and anything that could lock would just be a contention point. The idea isn't to have a file and have one node say, well, I have, you know, these other systems to lock on something, and then maybe that system dies, and then the other 9,000 systems are waiting on this lock. So the whole architecture, you can obviously write code as locking if you need it for your application. It works best if you think in a partitionable way. Okay, so we want to do a use case. So we want to talk about large-scale log processing. Now, a web log is a lot like any, you know, data set. It's got columns, source IP, destination IP, web page you're looking for. And the tricks are, anyone ever tried to store a lot of web logs in MySQL, let's say? Did it work?
Not well.
Not well, okay, perfect. The problem really is, I've read this in a lot of different scenarios, is that all relational databases are great when you can keep your data indexed and the file caches are in memory. If you start getting so much data that the indexes or data files have to be continually swapped in and out, your performance is going to go from real time to almost never happening. Other challenges, you may want to store it indefinitely, like we want to maybe keep all our logs forever. We don't want to rotate them off in 30 days. We want to keep them for years. And then, you know, once we have these large data sets, how can we actually utilize all these machines to process them? You know, that's where MapReduce comes in. So I just wanted to start here with tackling this problem. So I made, I just took my regular Apache logs and I inserted these control A delimiters. I don't know if you guys, control B, control A, yes, the Hive format. You can use other delimiters, but this is the default one, so it's the easiest. Nothing really to tell there. So this would actually be the simplest way to get your data into Hadoop, which is just use the built-in shell commands. You know, there's obviously an API if you want to do a fancier way, but the short way, just copy from local. It's there. And then from that point on, you know, HDFS will take care of the replication, you know, whatever else. Okay? And I just went into the shell a little more. So here's a way, like, this would be the most minimal way you could use Hadoop, you know? I'll just use it. It's hard to see from that where you guys are, but I could use the DFS cat, you know, cat a file I'm looking for, you know, 5 minutes ahead. So I don't need to jump all the way into MapReduce and yada, yada, yada. I still have this file. I can just look at it and do whatever I need to do with it. Process it in Perl, process it in C, doesn't matter. So I just wanted to get into this a little bit, so I'm going to do a more specific example. So a web log might look something like this, where you have your time of the log, a bunch of other columns, your status, and then the page people went to. So this is like any database. It's got rows and it's got columns, and they're all the same type down the way. These are the explanations I never understand. I don't know, anyone like this kind of stuff? This is like a very mathematical explanation of what MapReduce does. I just put it there because like the hex, I want to be cool with it. So here's how I think it works. So we have our source file here. This is the same file from before. We split it. So the first half goes to one place, the second half goes to two. And then a mapper, which is a process running on one of your, you know, many thousands of data nodes, will get each split.
You're splitting it horizontally, not vertically, right?
Well, we're splitting a file just by chunks. So if we have a file, it'll split it into the blocks. Okay. You can split by line if you want, but no, you're not splitting vertically.
Okay.
This might be hard to see, too. I actually included just a little mapper. Oh. What I'm trying to do here, by the way, is actually count. So I have a set of web logs, and I just want to see how many people went to what page. So the end report should be like, let me go back. So the end report here should be two hits on the index page, one hit on the igloo page, and one hit on the end page. So make it a little more clear. So here's the framework you're going to work with. It's a little convoluted, but the bulk of it is, you get the text as a string, then you split it, and output the part you want. That's the map phase. So what this is going to do is, when this is all done, it's going to output index one. This is my only joke in the presentation, so try to laugh. Shuffle sort is not the hottest new dance move. What happens here is when you have your intermediate output, all the keys that are indexed should end up over here. See that? From the first mapper, one of the indexes came out over here, and they went this way. So what we got here is we're shuffled by a hash, and then we're always sorted. So that's one of the pieces of how the framework divides and conquers. We can sort, and then we can put other pieces. Here's the reduce size. So the reduce here, we're getting input like this, index 1, 1, and we just want to count it. So we're saying, for the values, count this up. You know, very basic operation. And this is really the final output, is that you'll get N1, index 2, equal HTML. So that's the whole, that's a short, sweet version of MapReduce, really. And this is the interesting part, you know, why is it scalable? Anybody want to pitch in, throw anything at me? No? All right. Well, we can split the file, right? We can split our source file. So we can process as many splits as we want simultaneously. The more machines we have, the more splits we can process. And if we really can't process fast enough, we can always buy more hardware. You know, adding a node to the Hadoop is very easy. The system is very easy. You just pretty much bring it online. It's on. It's part of the cluster. And the only pieces of it, as I mentioned here, that are redundant are the name node, the job tracker, and you can use, you know, standard practices to make them redundant. You can use an HA solution or just heavily backed up. Oh, this is pretty important. If you lose a data node or a pass tracker, it doesn't affect anything. What happens is Hadoop is always trying to maintain a certain number of copies of your file. So let's say you have a 10-node cluster and no 10 dies. Well, there was theoretically 3 copies of your file. There's still 2 available, so the file isn't missing. And Hadoop could go out and just grab, it will start to re-replicate those missing files, other nodes. So that's a background process. You don't have to take any action if one of your machines dies on you. So Hive is really cool because if you saw the MapReduce code segments I do, probably many people are like, I don't want to write code, you know? And so Hive is cool because it lets you just write SQL on top of files already in Hadoop. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do the same example I just did, the Hive way. Quick notes is, you know, Hive doesn't have a format. So it's not like MySQL where you load data into MySQL. It has to reformat and reindex it. It actually works in the same raw data you loaded in, which is pretty cool. And here's how it works. What you really have to do is specify a schema for the file, so you say what the columns you're expecting are. Pretty, you know, it takes a while for a shot, but you know, you just specify whether it's a string or an integer. There's a few other types like date, etc. And then you load your data. This is the file we got before. We just loaded it. So that's it. 2 steps. If this file was already on Hadoop, this would be a sub-second operation. It's loaded. Whereas if you try to load maybe 4 gigs of data into MySQL, might take you 60 minutes, might take you 4 hours, depends. And then we're doing the same thing with the query like language, where we can select the URL and account, really the same thing we were doing before, and group. Anyone know SQL? SQL users? Alright, that looks like SQL, right? So there's no brain power here. Just like, oh cool. I ran a query on a regular file. Pretty neat, right? This is like a little bit of the output of what happens when a job runs. It's a little small, sorry about that. But more or less you run your query, select URL count from web data. Do I
have a question? I'm sorry.
You do some job processing. And down here you can see the results of all the people who went to my bulletin boards. I had a big month with 12 hits here. So looking to go to maybe 13, 14 next month. And as you can see, this query took a pretty long time. It did run on my laptop. But as I said, it's not a low latency system. So I can't get this query down to 5 seconds actually. But you're not really geared for these low-end, smaller queries. You would be running this query across a 4 terabyte data set. And it would almost be intractable with most relational database systems that I've worked with. But Hive could actually do it in a predictable time frame. And this is my great contribution to society. If you don't like CLIs, I helped put the Hive web interface into Hive. So this is kind of cool because Hadoop Hive, their command line tools, but you might want a way to let someone else at your company analyze the data. You know, most people don't understand, okay, get these jar files, install Java, SSH into that machine, now do this, and keep that window open. So High Web Interface is just a cool way to get going, run queries. It keeps the session open, so with Hive, you saw the query took 30 seconds, maybe a query takes 2 hours. Well, you don't want to keep your CLI window open for 2 hours while it's running, so you can let the web interface handle it. Here's just the data preview mode, another screenshot. That's it.
All right.
What's up?
Can you talk about the split with the map process a little more? I mean, you have arbitrary input files, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so there's some API. What's the actual process of how do you, how do you want to split things up?
Yeah.
It seems very important.
Yeah, well, there's lots of different ways. So the default input is a text input. So it assumes the row delimiter is a line and the column delimiter is a tab. That's overridable. You can change the delimiter if you want.
So if I wanted to, the
controls
sort of process a binary file?
Yes, there is. There's you could actually throw a zip file into Hadoop and it knows how to work with it. If it's not in text, you could create your own input format into Hadoop or Hive.
So creating your own input format, I mean, you're basically then just telling it byte positions and using that to divide things up?
Yes, exactly. The only challenges with it are some formats aren't splittable. Like if you have an LZO file, for example, it's compressed, it's binary, but the only way to read an LZO file is from the beginning to the end. So Hadoop can't help you with that. Whereas a bzip file is splittable, so it can do that. But yeah, just,
sorry.
No, it's okay.
And then, so then the logic that you can apply is how you want it distributed. So let's say I was using some oddball file that I wanted to process. I have control over how that, so I set up basically sections of a file, I split it up. And then I can control how to push that out, or I mean, how does it know what is kind of reproducible, what is
right. Yes, I understand. It works, it's hard to explain, but I'll be able to go. With a text file, say you have a file that's 1 gigabyte and the block size is 128 megabytes, it will split at 128 megabyte boundaries. And there's some logic in it so that even if you're splitting between a line, like 128 megabits falls in the middle of a line, one mapper won't process that line and the other line, other mapper will. So you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And if it's a binary format that you created, you have to kind of go in the API and tell it how to find those offsets.
So there's an input format API that you provide a Java class that overrides it. You provide a method that says, you know, get input splits, and you just apply an implementation to that. And it gives it a set of, input split objects, which are basically like a start offset, end offset, you know. Here's your chunk of the file to process.
Can I control the sequence, or do I expect it to happen randomly? The process to reducing
the maps have to be completely random because you're just taking an input row and producing an output row. It doesn't. The only thing that matters is that row. So I mean, they could happen all sequentially. They could happen all at the exact same time. Same difference. No. Well, by the nature of the API, there's no reason you would want to control it because, you know, you're taking one input row and producing one output row for each row, so there's no reason to care what order it happens in.
If you look at the example I did, that process, selecting the by page from the hits and the count, it doesn't matter what order you do that in, the result is always the same. And that's one of the concepts. If there's something in the first row that dictates how the millionth row is processed, that's not a great problem for Hadoop to solve.
Deterministic, right?
It's deterministic. Yes, it would be deterministic in that case. It's the same thing with a database table. If you have a table and you select and count, no matter if you were in pieces, you would get, you know, the same results.
Well,
go on.
What's the atomic unit, the smallest atomic unit?
Well, the map function is given the row. So the smallest unit in the framework is just a line or a row, or whatever you define to be a row. And then you could chop that up. In my case, my rows are delimited by control A. So then my smallest unit is, you know, one element in that row.
So you can, it doesn't have to, it's not like hard coded. A line is definable by your.
Yeah, so that's what you said about the input format. Is the default format is just use text files, tabs, the splitter, new line is the row, but you can tell it to use other delimiters. Like you can tell it to use CSV delimiters possibly, or use, you know, any ASCII character.
I guess what I'm trying to think is like if you were thinking like an offhand of having just a simple database where you're defining multiple rows per record that are new line delimited, but you've got like a spacer between the rows. I'm just trying to understand like how much flexibility you have to define the data set that's going in.
You were pretty good at now. As I said, the only thing that's problematic is things that you can't start in the middle and find the record start. If you had some data set like PCAP, which doesn't have a split, you have to process it from the beginning to understand the end. That's not, otherwise you could teach it, okay, my format is a regex. The first column's here, or my format is a CSV. So the first column's before the first column, the second column's, or my format's binary, so read 10 bytes, then read 10 more bytes, then next line. You know, all that stuff you could do. Go ahead, Mom.
So, a couple of questions about implementation details, but one that's really fun to me. The implementation of Hadoop itself in Java, is there any talk about, as Hadoop's gained popularity, about standardizing or sticking with a slower, how to put it, Java implementation path, or basically, what I'm looking at, you're at a BSD meeting, right? And seeing as the only officially supported blessed Java that exists is Sun's Java on FreeBSD, that's not a bad thing at the end of the day. There's some very cool features that could affect these big jobs, right? They're very cool, like Superpages implementation on FreeBSD 8. This could be a real boon in performance for big jobs. Is there any thought or any, been looking around and couldn't find much about the kind of just, you know, operational kind of, making the Hadoop implementation a little more predictable as we go along?
So the question is Java slow? That's really it in a nutshell.
Not necessarily, but is there, you know, at a BC meeting, it seems like a really big implementation, the big uses and implementations or deployments of Hadoop end up being in environments that are largely Linux. Mm-hmm. Most of it is getting at the most recent Java stuff. It's very, very much easier.
I understand. Well, I did make a quick port of Hadoop for FreeBSD, so you should give it a try and tell me if it works. But Hadoop is compatible with pretty much any version of Java, including the version of the FreeBSD version of Java is very close. I think it's 1.67. The latest Sun is probably 1.617, so it's very close feature-wise. And, you know, it's good, it's up with the times. But you shouldn't need to have a bleeding-edge JVM to run any of this stuff. Just the recent one would do it for you. And in terms of are other people doing this, sure, there's a Python MapReduce library and a Perl one, and there's BashReduce, and MySpace, since they use .NET, has their own MapReduce library. So sure, there's people that are recoding it and doing different languages. And it's just, the MapReduce is really a paradigm. It's not tied to Java in any way. And the original Google file system is written in C++. You know, I'll say my buddies who created Hive are from Facebook. So they thought about it really hard and said, we're going to use Java for whatever reason, you know? So there are big people using it. Yahoo is kind of like one of the flagship guys of Hadoop. So they're not looking to rework anytime soon to a different language.
Then I guess my second question is, are there plans for, and where would we find more information about plans for the development of HDFS, specifically some of POSIX file semantics, and mostly things like access controls, permissions. Wow, Mac would be ridiculously, you know, awesome. and overblown, but like, you know, I think about that with regard to things like the web UI. When unleashing this in an organization, if you're suddenly giving a business group access to run queries, a bunch of staff people doing business work, get into situations now where I'm wondering basically about safety, about security, about thinking about how to actually partition up very, very large data installations where you want to actually, you really want to give freedom to a business unit or a group or so-and-so who's using, who wants to use the data and do something with it, but you really don't want to give that group keys to the kingdom, right? So
yes.
Is there any thought being put into those issues?
Definitely a weakness now. Definitely a weakness. One of the popular techniques is just secure it by API, which is kind of okay because if you think about it, if most auditors or other people aren't going to be able to understand or run queries anyway. But so that is a problem. What they're doing is the next couple of generations of Hadoop is going to use Kerberos actually. It's a very complex install, but that's going to allow you to, when you run a MapReduce job, there's some really great slides on it. Owen O'Malley did them at Hadoop World. It's a really tricky process because when I start a job in Hadoop as my user, Edward, I have to, for this to work, I have to, this process is going to run on Edward on lots of different machines, so I have to punch a Kerberos ticket and hand that off to a process, which is going to hand that off to other processes. They are working on it. They are working on it. Right now, security is to, you know, block it off and design some interface to it, web interface, or whatever else you're working on. There is file permissions. And then what you asked about the PostScript semantics, well, there's append. Originally, we didn't even have append. Believe that. There is append. The other stuff they're not gonna do because that hurts the consistency. When you're running a query over 10 terabytes of data, how are you going to account for what changed while this 6-hour query was going on? It's a problem to tackle. I'm not saying they won't do it. I'm not that keen into it, but the idea was that they made these kind of rigid restrictions so that allows you to do kind of stuff like this, you know, lazy replication. Go ahead, Adam.
Yeah, how does backup, what kind of ways would you back up data in
VFS? Other HDFS. I mean, really, this
is
a huge...
work to you?
Well, it depends on what you're, if it's important enough to, you know, back it up. I mean,
but
in our
example...
You
go through the file system and then you suck it out and you put it back in there, you know, or as a file, but or would you just forge actually go to the block level?
You could do that. If there was certain pieces of data that are important to you, there is actually a fuse module, and if you had like a standard backup software, you could fuse mount it and back certain stuff up. There is just basic, there's a dist copy command, so it's a distributed kind of copy command. That would probably be the best way. You could dist cp to an FTP server or another. That's probably how most people back up. With dist cp, they just point at a section of the tree. And dist cp actually runs the MapReduce job, which gets the list of all the files, and then has the whole cluster copied into another whole cluster. So a parallelized Hadoop rsync, if you would. The guy in the back, he had a question, sorry.
I'm wondering, does it keep track of like slow machines versus fast machines? Does it know when might be a slow machine in the grid that, or a node or whatever that maybe shouldn't send as many requests to, or
yes and no. Hadoop doesn't really like break down and say, oh, how much RAM do you have? How many processors do you have? Oh, you're no good for this. It makes some general assumptions that the capability of the systems are similar. But that doesn't mean that they can't be different. You could have different configurations. And what will happen if the machine is hurt, let's say, running bad, that would be the main concern, it will get blacklisted. So I don't know what the criteria for blacklisting is, but if enough jobs fail on that machine or don't complete in a timely fashion, that node will get blacklisted.
That's good.
Yeah. You next.
Can you just say something about when you're saying, I think on one of your slides, that the idea is not to move data, but I'm not clear exactly what that means. You've obviously got to map out. Give us an example of something that you're saving bandwidth or CPU cycles, not all stuff like that.
If you look at the example job I did, the select and count, right? Imagine if I was doing that on a local file, right? That would be much faster than if I was doing that on an NFS file, correct? Right, just in general, local files faster than NFS. Since we have this grid framework, that part of the job should hopefully run on that machine. If it can't, that's okay, because it is a distributed file system, and even if the process runs here and the data is there, that's okay. Hadoop tries to schedule that task to run on that particular node. So that's what they mean, boot processing, not data.
But then you have to move the data to the node. That's what I'm asking.
Well, by default, it tries to run that process on the node. If it can't, all the nodes could access all the other nodes' data remotely. So it's just a difference of whether it's locally off Hadoop or off another node in Hadoop.
So you're saying if you have like a 40 terabytes and you're pushing it out to machines, that you're going to have replication maybe 3x. And so for your particular discrete data set that you're looking for, it's going to go to that machine that has it. And it's not actually,
That's the concept. Generally, it's not much worse though if it doesn't do it remote. You next, you had a question for it. So got it? Yeah.
Yeah, okay, so coming back to the Hive, if you define two tables and you want to do a report that's based on two tables, for example, a join, can you do a query that joins two tables together? And does it figure out the best strategy for joining those two tables together?
Okay. Hyperjoins, you have to join on an equals. That's just because the way MapReduce works. And actually, since you seem to know a lot about this topic, Hive is being interesting. MySQL does AB joins, left right joins. So if you're doing A join B join C join D, it has to do them in that order. But Hive actually does them simultaneously through the map. It's very tricky to explain. There's some slides on it, I can maybe point you to them. So there are joins, and they actually are pretty optimized. We see you had a lot of questions today.
Can you order your results, and also is there any standards like JDBC 3.0, JDBC 4.0,
different levels of SQL? There is ordering. There's a lot of stuff. Pretty much most of the things that you'd expect in SQL. There's some exceptions, but most of it. There is a JDBC driver as well.
It's pretty limited though.
Yes, it is limited. It's more for almost experimentation at this point. Not experimentation. You can hook up certain query tools with it and do some queries, but you'd be better off with CLI. In the back?
Does the ordering happen in the client, or does it actually happen?
No, it happens in MapReduce. For certain queries in Hive, that's a one MapReduce. It'll actually spawn multiple MapReduce jobs. So if I did that job, select the page and account, order by the page, that would turn into two MapReduce jobs, where the first one might do select count, and the second one would roll through and do the order by. Go for it.
What sort of, are there any metrics that you go out to 10 servers, the job control server, in terms of, does it have to actually have to start partitioning the job, or is that not? If you do 10,000 servers, what's happening with the job control?
Well, what happens in the job control is, say I was running that query, is you can specify how many mappers or reducers to use per job, and that's pretty important. For example, if you have a super small data set, let's say 10 megabytes, it really makes no sense to choose 1,000 mappers and 1,000,000 reducers, because it doesn't make the job faster, it makes it slower, because you're just making framework overhead. So, in other words, you would have to intelligently, it by default figures out something, but you, by sitting and tuning those two variables, you could get a much better result. Just by taking some intelligent numbers based on just using Hadoop for a while, you could say, all right, this is about 4 gigs.
Well, I was actually meaning just the overhead of the machine that's actually running the control. Is that manageable? Don't worry about it. You're running 100,000 servers.
The controller job, the job tracker, doesn't actually do much. It actually is a queue of things it wants people to run, and the task trackers come and pick up jobs and do them. That's a lot like the name, though. The idea is it's a little backwards. Those things aren't proxying work. They're mostly queues, and then the other tasks pick up those jobs and execute them. So actually, the name and the job tracker are very light. They do none of the processing.
Anyone else? Oh, one more. Go for it.
Just for my own benefit, though, this Hadoop is not designed to be an online view. It's not even like on like Mongo or something. It is for large offline batch processing.
Yes, the core of Hadoop is a batch processing system, and Hive is too. But there are Hadoop sub-projects, like one is called HBase, which is the key value score on top of HDFS, which I guess is similar to Voldemort, if you're into that type of things. It would almost be like a distributed Voldemort. So there is...
The Mongo is the big popular one. The key value pair has used on...
Yeah, if you're interested in that, look at HBase. And there's a company called Streamy, which did a really great presentation at Hadoop World, where they describe how they did real-time web serving. So just a PHP front end and HBase. That's it, no middle ground.
Of course.
Just
Hive
or HBase have any way to know where data is in terms of partitioning? Or will it always do a complete sequential scan of all the data?
Hive is very good with partitioning. That was what it was designed for. A Hive partition is essentially a folder. It's very, because remember you're storing text files, so my example. So if you create I didn't include partitioning in my example, I'm sorry. But if you partition by year, and all the files for that year will be in one folder, and the query optimizer will prune by that folder. So you can make as much partitioning as you want. And then there's another concept called bucketing, where you could hash a value and divide that into X number of buckets. So you could maybe partition by year, month, day, and bucket by user ID. That's a classic example. And then the buckets are cool because you could use the buckets to do sampling. That's a really advanced feature of Hive, even I don't use it. But if you're sampling a huge data set saying select top five, isn't really a good sample. You know what I'm saying? Because you would, if you have a two-table data set that's huge, you would have to join them before sampling, right? But with bucketing, you could join on the buckets and sample on the buckets. So pretty neat. HBase doesn't have that concept because it's trying to be like an online fast access key value store. It's just a key value store. It's not a table store like SQL.
Do the nodes optimize on CPU or
memory? Asking again, I'm sorry?
If you have a choice among nodes, do you go with more memory or more CPU?
They don't check that. The node, basically the job tracker is a list of jobs that needs to be done. The task tracker just comes on and says...
But it just in terms of the normal types of mapped processes that are sent out. Usually
yeah. IO now. Yeah. Very good. Yeah. A lot of the system, it actually uses a lot of disks. Hadoop, it's great to have lots of disks because whereas a regular database works on memory trees and hash maps.
Excuse me, I'm sorry.
Hadoop is always spilling files. So you would think that disk IO is really slow, but in these cases it's actually very fast. And if I could give you a quick example, we happen to have a huge MySQL cluster we were trying to stick our web logs in. We had 4 gigabytes of data. And just doing that query, select count, actually involves, once you hit a certain size in MySQL for the result set, it can't keep that table in memory anymore. It has to spill it to disk, and there goes all your performance. You know, all that in-memory stuff, now you're spilling because there's just too many output rows. So Hadoop naturally spills because it likes writing to disk, which, like I said, on the low latency stuff is bad. But on the high latency stuff, it's the only way to actually do it. Well, not the only way, but a good way to do it.
So, could you? I know Hadoop can be used for many other purposes other than just being
this like super database that has a streaming API. And could you maybe expand on that? I know it's not your area of expertise, but there are some other things that like you could do with Hadoop that we didn't talk about today.
On the streaming API?
Yeah.
Okay. You actually can use a Perl or a shell script. You actually can use a Perl or a shell script as part of a Hadoop process. It's called streaming. Mark asked about it. And instead of doing your map function in Java, you could actually pipe it out to a program which would return a result back to the pipe, and you could use that. An example of how I use that is I was interested in using GeoIP Perl to GeoIP locate an IP I had in my web logs. So I was actually able to use Hadoop and Hive, pipe the IP out to this GeoIP Perl script, and read the result back in. So you can use it with external processes in some situations.
Oh, that's a good ask.
Yeah, what Hadoop has is it has something called the distributed cache where you put files into the cache, and as the job runs, those files are replicated to all nodes. So if I have that Perl script, I got a pretty distributed cache, Hadoop will carry that to all the nodes, and then it'll be there when I need it.
So in the Hadoop shell, there's like some sort of like system escape or something to be able to call that stuff escape and get it out like shell script.
Ask me again, I'm sorry.
What's the actual syntax when you're actually leaving a new space, so to speak, piping out to an external program on a node and coming back in?
All right, so answer that. The Hadoop shell that I showed you with the ls and the cat, that's limited to a few commands. What you're doing when you're doing that is you're bringing in a Hadoop process called streaming. So you actually say Hadoop, you specify streaming libraries, input file, output file, and then the third and fourth arguments are like the name of the script. I don't use it very often, but so that's, in other words, how you would do it. So the streaming takes the things out to the cache. If you're writing a command line program, if you're writing through the API, normally the new programs are written in the Java API, there's a distributed cache dot add my script.
That's it. Oh, no.
Is there any plans for putting system redundancy in the main node?
Yes, I'll leave that. Right now there is a secondary name node, which is a semi-copy of it, but there is plans to have a name node active and passive and the failover mechanism. But a couple of my buddies, they didn't make it tonight, but they have a doc on how to use Linux HA and replicate. Have you ever used Linux HA? So Linux HA is a high availability protocol that works usually with DRDB. So they have a doc, how do you HA my name node? And we can do it because it's a batch system. For our purposes, we're doing batch log processing. If it's out, okay, cool. Now I'll get over there, we'll rebuild it, we'll whatever, we'll start from backup. It doesn't have to be 100% available for our purpose. So we just block the hardware and a RAID.
Can the name node be reconstructed from what's in the TFS, or is that the only place where essentially the directory hides?
No, we cannot. Cannot be reconstructed. The data in HDFS is just stored as data, so if you look at that file, you'll have a hard time putting it back together.
So there's no metadata stored anywhere?
There's not, and that's an interesting question, because the concept was like, if you have lots of metadata, you could have things go out of sync. So having just one copy of this data, alleviates that issue. Imagine you had a data node that had some metadata, it died, 6 hours later it comes back with your metadata. Now you have to go around all 1,000 nodes and saying, all right, who's got the quorum? What's the right metadata here? You know, I think mine's right. Well, mine's newer, you know, cloud, or there goes your file. So they didn't go that way. What you can do is the name node data, you can write to multiple places. So it suggests you write it to two separate drives, or you can write to two NFS mounts. That's another way to go HA. You could just write all the name node data to two NFS mounts, and then you could pretty much bring another machine on as a front end.
The secondary name node is basically like
the equivalent of, you know, MySQL replication or something like that, right? It's just like a few seconds behind.
No, it's not. It's something totally different. It's the worst chosen name in history. The secondary name node, the name node keeps the whole file system in memory. So the secondary name node periodically does a checkpoint, writes that to a file, and then transfers it back to the name node. So it's actually critical. It's not secondary. You can't live without it. It does checkpointing and pushing.
But if you have it on a second node, then your data is replicated, right?
You can restore from the secondary, but you'll only get the data since the checkpoint. So, for example, if you do that, if you take your, let's say your checkpoint set to go out every 5 hours, and you take an old checkpoint. I lost the name node, I'm screwed. We take the secondary name node. It's 5 hours old. As soon as you start up that name node, the other data nodes will check into it, and they'll say, hey, I got all these files. And the name node will say, I don't know anything about those files, delete them. You know? So, that's what you get.
Go ahead.
As long as there's no new files changing in any way, the data node is not changing, correct? So that would basically be where you would back it up. Or is there a way that you can do a backup so it kind of freezes the data node so you can do the backup?
It wouldn't really be super effective to back up a data node because a data node just has blocks of all different files. It doesn't have one logical file. I mean, it may around it contain a logical file, but you couldn't reconstruct it, you couldn't do anything with it. So you could back up a data node directly now. If you back up all your data nodes, I guess you could. But this system kind of isn't made for a backup. I mean, the concept is like, I have so much data, I can't keep it anywhere else. The only way we really have it is, there is work on a checkpointing system, by the way.
That's not what you turn on the redundancy and reblock it somewhere else.
Well, that actually begs the question of then, there is a failure mode to worry about, actually, where you get into a bug in Hadoop, a bug in HDFS, a bug in basically a program or something that's working on and with data that produces, like, you know, irreversible data corruption of some type, right? So the idea of trying to get the actual HDFS off the system is that beyond just replicating the blocks, there is, you know, programs and humans screw up.
Oh, sure.
Right?
RMRS, you know, there it goes. Wow. Then backup, what's important to you? You know, it's a file system, it has a root, it has a user. Right. Put it somewhere important and back it up.
Go ahead.
Does secondary node keep multiple checkpoints that you go like, oh man, I put bad data and I want to go back 2 days ago?
Yes. That's the question was, does the secondary node have multiple checkpoints? Yes. It's configurable as many as you want.
Frequently that's the situation.
Yeah. That's one of my programs that was running.
So just to clarify something, when you put a file into HDFS, it splits it at that point. That's correct?
Yes.
It's across for processing as well, it's going to use whatever location the file ended up in as the optimal location to be processing, right?
The file is written, block by block to one data node, and then the replication is a lazy process. So.
Right, so initially, if it all fits on one data node, it's going to end up on one data node this far.
No, it'll go to different ones, but that block will only be in one place at a given time, and then the other data nodes will come and get it eventually. So, don't quote me on that. It gets replicated pretty quick. You can see this in action. You can have your replication set to 3 and then move it to 9, and you can keep refreshing and see the copies of it being made.
Well, my question is more, obviously, you want to have data as far as evenly distributed across your nodes as possible to be able to distribute the processing. Is that distribution done when the files are originally loaded, or does that happen at some point before the job runs, that data is moved around, or?
That distribution is round robin.
Okay, so when you load the files to begin with, it's just dropping blocks for those files round robin across the entire
What it tries to do is there's a concept of rack awareness. So imagine you had a data center with 4 racks and you had 40 nodes per rack. It tries to make one copy in the local rack and one copy in another rack. And this way, the concept behind that was the first copy will be very fast, because it's in the local rack, and a different machine in the local rack, and the second copy will be very safe, because it's somewhere else.
No, I mean, you can, with the blocks, you can get to a state that it's not the very issue, but in most cases, you can run a rebalance, like the test, and you'll try to clear the issue, so it has a process.
If you add like 20 nodes to your 20 node cluster, you probably want to run a rebalance so you don't have to have your nodes being empty.
In most cases, except for cases of data locality, you want that random assortment. Because, for example, if you have this concept like, oh, I want everything in this folder to be on one node.
That was what I was asking. I just wanted to know at what point does it do this distribution so that, like, as soon as you load something based on the things are as evenly distributed as, or optimally evenly distributed up to the size of the file based on the block size so that you're just ready to run at that point.
Background process is copying out.
Right? There's probably room for, I mean, just as there's room, they're working on a scheduler, you know, to have either a fair scheduler or a priority scheduler, you know, there's probably also room for maybe like recency with data, like how they want to, how it's not that sophisticated yet. It's still a bit like it's a round robin. But I said
there's
probably room for that
going
forward, right?
Yeah, well, the big thing is, like, how do I make it redundant on multiple data centers? That's like a big question. And then when you're talking about, like, pluggable block placement, if you would, that's what you're searching for. How do I get really fine-grained control? And to be honest, the API is really open. If you are a Hadoop backer, you could probably get in there and say, okay, write this and move this here. It is a pretty open API. So you could do it if you were really inclined.
Maybe you can talk a little bit about what we've done with Hadoop on previous state too.
Oh, that was pretty funny. So, you know, our Hadoop cluster is Linux. But, you know, I built it, I put it in our software deployment system. How does that happen? And someone hit me with, oh, cool, I want to submit jobs on previous state. First thing they asked for. And actually, what I was able to do is, everything was actually compatible with a previous JVM. All I had to do was do a couple of shims because I do things like add tests to the profile. And it ran just fine. So I actually, because it is Java-based, it is cross-platform, I was actually able to take the same install that I put on all the data nodes, bring it over to another previous machine, and it's just fine. JVM, couple shim files. So that worked out good.
Where do we get the port?
Fuck port. There's no port.
I made a port. If anyone wants to try it. Anyone else? All right, thank you guys.
Thank you.